Well, I need to tell you what all of these things are, but let me start with sort of, I guess, what is the broad picture of where we are and what kind of things we're thinking about. And so I think about similar sort of things that Scott does. So let me start by talking about manifolds. So, and I'm going to be a little bit vague because there's sort of a lot of background material, but it's a sort of visual and sort of, I think, accessible kind of subject, and so you can get into it without being entirely precise about the definitions. So let me start with a two-dimensional manifold, also known as a surface, here's the first piece of vagary, is a topological object, whatever that means, that locally looks like the plane or R squared. Let's have a few examples. So the sphere, surface of the Earth, is a surface or a two-dimensional manifold, and let's check that it satisfies this sort of definition. If I zoom in on a little part of it, if I just sort of ignore everything else and just look really close into it, then it looks like a piece of the plane. So this all works. Or here's the torus, so the surface of a bagel or a donut. And again, if I zoom in really closely on any point, it just looks like a little piece of the plane. It looks like a disc. It's the torus. Or you can carry on adding more holes or more handles. It's the genus 2 surface. Genus 2 surface, and so on. So there are many, many examples of these two-dimensional manifolds. Just because it's going to be useful, it'll come up again later on, let me give you another way to think about the torus. So if I take a square piece of paper, and I'm going to draw these sort of arrows on the edges, which are supposed to suggest to you that you're supposed to glue those edges together with the appropriate arrows matched up. So if I take a square piece of paper and I curl it around to identify, to glue together the two opposite edges, then I get a cylinder. So this becomes something that looks like this. So I've glued the single arrow edges together, and then this is sort of transparent. You can see through to the back, and my double arrow edges are still there, but then if I somehow roll this around to connect those two double arrow edges together, then I'm going to get the torus. So this is another way to think about the torus, by starting with a square and identifying the edges. Okay, so that's two-dimensional manifolds, which hopefully are kind of familiar things. But what I really want to talk about is three-dimensional manifolds. So a three-dimensional manifold, in the same sort of sense, is a topological object or maybe it's, in some circumstances, better to think of it as a topological space, something you can move around inside of, that locally looks like three-dimensional space. So what are some examples of this? Well, sort of the simplest example is three-dimensional space itself. So we are living inside of what appears, at least on the small scale, to be a three-dimensional manifold, because if I look at a small piece of space, it looks like R3. Let's have a more interesting example. So the three torus. So with these two-dimensional manifolds, these surfaces, you can sort of think about them sitting inside of the world that we live in, And you can imagine, okay, yes, I can see this, and it's sort of curved around in some way. This is difficult, more difficult to visualize for three-dimensional manifolds because we don't have a fourth dimension to curve things around in to have them glue together in some more complicated way. So it's better to think about them in terms of these sort of taking pieces and then gluing them together in some way. So how do you make a three torus? Well, you start with a cube. In fact, let me take this room as my cuboid that I'm gonna work with. And so what I did with the torus, otherwise known as the two torus, is I sort of glued opposite edges together to wrap it up and connect it together in an interesting way. We're going to do the same thing here. We're going to say I'm going to glue the board wall to the windows wall, which means that as I walk through this wall, I'm actually going to come back on through this wall, and I go out that way, and I come in this way. And if I climb up a ladder and poke my head through the ceiling, it'll come in through the floor and so on. So this is an example. Okay, so well, let's just check. Is that a three manifold? Well, so does it locally look like three-dimensional space? If I pick any point in the space, you have to check, you know, if I zoom in really close on that point, does it just look like three-dimensional space? So what do we have to check? So let's pick a point in this space. Well, here's one. Yes, okay, fine, looks like three-dimensional space. But you also have to think about, well, what about if my point is sort of on this face of this cuboid? Then if I zoom in really close, what do I see? Well, I'm going to see sort of like a little hemisphere here on this wall, but I'm going to see another little hemisphere on the other wall, and they're going to glue together, and I'm going to make my little bit of three-dimensional space, so this works. And you can check the edges, and you check the corners as well, and everything works. So this is an example of a three-manifold. And as you might imagine, it gets a little bit tricky to visualize what's going on. You sort of have to look at small pieces and understand from there. And similarly, we can define an N-manifold for any natural number of dimensions. So here's a little exercise. What are the possible one-manifolds? So two-manifolds are also known as surfaces. One-manifolds are also known as curves. And remember, we're topologists for now, so we don't actually care about the precise shape of things. We only care about sort of things up to squishiness. So somebody name me a one-manifold. Who doesn't have a PhD in mathematics already?
A circle.
A circle. Yes, a circle is an example of one-manifold. What's another one? Circle's a good example. So we had this kind of example of a three-dimensional manifold.
A pretzel?
I'm not sure what a pretzel is in the context of...
I guess I'm just trying to think of something like that's some a line in an interesting shape that connects back to itself that is in a circle.
Ah, well, right. So there's a bit of a complication here in that I guess I haven't actually drawn a knot yet. So this is knotted in space, but as far as the thing itself is concerned, it's really just a circle. Right, this is a little bit of a complication, but yeah, no, I mean, it's right. It's a very good point, but for the purposes of this, not what I'm counting. Any other thoughts? One manifolds that are not the circle?
The entire real line.
The entire real line, yes. That's the other example I was looking for. And other than strange things that involve uncountable collections of... You know what I'm talking about, but probably nobody else does. That's it for one manifolds.
So what if you have two lines? Oh, sorry.
Two lines. Okay. Connected one manifolds. Okay. all right. So we've got a little bit of experience with what these things are. Now, so I want to talk about this knot, the figure eight knot. So I guess let me draw a couple of pictures of knots. I've already got this knot here. This is called the trefoil knot. And the knot that I'm really interested in, my favorite knot, the favorite knot of all hyperbolic geometers, is the figure eight knot. Now we're talking about a curve, and yes, very good. Okay, now we're talking about curves embedded in space. So there was, yes. Yes, it is just a circle, but it makes a difference. So there's another way to make a three-manifold. So we had one construction gluing together a cube in various ways. So the complement of a knot in three space is a three-manifold. So I need to tell you, so three-manifold is short for three-dimensional manifold, so I need to tell you what this means and how to do this. So what do you do? So what you do is you take three space and you drill out a tube following the knot. So let's try doing this. So I've drawn this as just a curve, just a one-dimensional thing here, but I want to think about thickening this up just a little bit. Do something like this. And I want to think of this as just sort of drilled out a little bit so that I've got a tube. So this is this model here is sort of showing a tube around a knot. This it turns out is the same as the figure eight knot here. This is a little hard to visualize, but let me try and convince you that this thing, I'll hand this around, is the same thing as this thing. So you notice here. If I forget about this, it looks like I've got these two strands that are kind of clasping through each other, like this. And then if I forget about this one, I've got two strands that are clasping through each other down here. And in between those two, if I sort of cut through here, then I go through these four strands that are going down here. Okay, and what's going on here, if I cut through this way, there are four strands here that I cut through, and at the top there's a clasp of two strands, and at the bottom there's a clasp of two strands. So that's how to see that these two things are the same thing. So I'll hand this around. Here's another one, not quite as fancy, but the same knot. So I'll hand this around as well. Okay, so that's the figure eight knot, and so the idea is that we're going to drill out this tube, and then then what am I claiming? So I'm claiming that if you take three-dimensional space and you drill this thing out, that's also a three-manifold. Now, that's a slight lie. So what's the definition? So the definition is I look at a small part of it, I zoom in enough, and it looks like three-dimensional space. So if I'm not near the knot, if I'm somewhere far away from it, then sure, I zoom in, I see a little bit of three-dimensional space. And you have to worry, what happens as I get closer to the knot? So as I get closer to the knot, maybe this is a very big zoomed-in version of the knot. And what if I sort of look at this point that's sort of right on the knot itself? Then something slightly different happens. I don't see that around me is three-dimensional space. It looks like I've only got half of three-dimensional space. So maybe I've got this little hemisphere here where I can't go down anymore because that's where I've drilled it out. So this is really... So this is really a three-manifold with boundary. And what this means is, this means that it can locally look like either three-dimensional space or the half space which we could write down as, say, the points in three-dimensional space, but where the z-coordinate has to be greater than or equal to zero. So it's only the things above the xy plane. So we're allowed to see things like this as well. Okay, so with that definition, then this is a three-manifold with boundary. So there's two sort of big questions when you start thinking about these things. Well, when certain people start thinking about these things. Well, the first is how can we write down a description of a three-manifold or a three-manifold with boundary, because you need to be able to write these things down so you can write papers about them and tell other people what you're doing. But even worse, what if I want a computer to understand what I'm talking about? So, I mean, it's all very well that here I am drawing pictures and you get what's going on with your highly evolved brains that are used to living in three-dimensional space and thinking about these things. But if I want to tell a computer what's going on and I want it to do calculations for me, this is not going to cut it. I need something else to do. So let's see. I guess I'll carry on over on this board for a little bit and then maybe I'll wrap around over there. I guess the board needs to be glued to itself as well. Okay, so triangulations are one way to do this. So they're one way to precisely describe what a three-manifold is, and they're really good for computers to work with as well. So you can do calculations based on them. So again, let's start with the two-dimensional case. It's easier to see what's going on, and then we'll move on to the three-dimensional case. Actually, I just remembered before I do anything else. So what's this model here? This is also the figure eight knot complement. It's the same model as that one that's over there. The difference is that if you think about that one over there, we've drilled out the knot in front of us and we're standing outside of that drilled part. And so we're inside of the three-manifold when we're looking at it like this. In this case, we've drilled out everything and we're standing inside of the drilled out part. So here, holding in my hands, is this three-manifold, the thing that I care about. That one, you're holding the drilled part, you're not holding the three-manifold itself. So I guess let me pass that around as well. It's a little tricky to... Maybe if they find their way back to each other, then you can try and contemplate what operation it is that puts your head inside of that thing so that it looks like that. Okay, but let me talk about triangulations of surfaces. So again, I'm not going to be completely precise because it's only an hour here and it's more interesting to do it a little bit vaguely. So a triangulation of a surface I'm going to take to be is a decomposition of the surface into triangles. So maybe I've got, here's my sphere. I'm drawing the equator on just so you can see it's a sphere rather than a disk. And so maybe I've cut it up into triangles in some way. Something like this, who knows. And I keep going and I tile the surface with triangles. But this is sort of an inefficient triangulation. There's an awful lot of triangles. Well, I haven't even drawn them all. There's an awful lot of vertices and edges and so on. So you can ask, what's the most efficient way you can do this? So in fact, let me ask, how many triangles do we need to triangulate the torus? So here's this two torus. So what I need to do is cut it up into triangles glued together along their edges with as few as possible triangles. Any thoughts from people who don't have PhDs in mathematics? Yeah?
Well, if you're looking at the little square thing,
yes,
you could just cut that.
Indeed, you could. Very good. So yes, so the smallest triangulation of the torus requires two triangles, because here's how you do it. Well, here we are. I've got two triangles, triangle one and triangle two, and these are glued together like this, and then they're glued together like this, and they're glued together like this, and I'm done. So you could ask, well, wait a minute, I mean, what about drawing this on here, which I hadn't thought about doing before just now, but let's try it anyway. I have thought about this in some sense before. It's going to look something like, oh, this is a difficult one. Let's go down around there. Am I doing this right, Scott?
Yep.
Okay, good. So that's a little bit tricky to see, but let me just make a comment about this. When you see it drawn on here, you'll notice there's only one vertex. And we can see why there's only one vertex just looking at this picture here. Right, so it looks at first, if I say, well, there's two triangles, you say, oh, 2 times 3, there must be 6 vertices. But you immediately say, well, no, the vertex here of this triangle is the same as the vertex here of this triangle. So, okay, really there's only 4 vertices. And then you start gluing these things up. You say, well, you know, the tip of the single arrow is glued to the tip of the single arrow here, so this vertex is really the same as this vertex. And this vertex is really the same as this vertex, and then you glue these up again and again. And there's only one vertex when you're done with all of this gluing. So, so 2 points. One, efficient triangulations have very few vertices, typically only one, because if you've got 2 vertices, then maybe you can get rid of them and get rid of some triangles as you do it. And 2, a computer could have done this easily. Right? A computer, you can write down, you can tell it a data structure with, here's a collection of triangles, and here's how they're glued to each other along their edges, and this will get all of the information you care about. Okay, so I think maybe I'll write one more half board and then I'll switch over. So this was triangulations of a surface of a 2-manifold. So a triangulation of a 3-manifold is a decomposition of it into tetrahedra. So that the 3-dimensional version of a triangle is a tetrahedron. So what's the picture? So here's a tetrahedron. So there's one vertex in the back behind the other, behind this big triangular face here, and then maybe I've got another tetrahedron here. And maybe I'll glue this face to this face the way that I've drawn it, like this. So I glue these two tetrahedra together along that face, and then somehow I glue the other faces together. Maybe I've got other tetrahedra. And I glue these together, and I make my 3-manifold. So you could sort of imagine how you might do this for, say, the 3-torus or something like this. But what I really want to do is this figure 8 knot complement. So that's a manifold with boundary. So there's a slightly better thing you can do for manifolds with boundary. So for 3-manifolds with boundary, it's better to use truncated tetrahedra. Truncated tetrahedra. So what's the idea here? So here's a tetrahedron. So the operation of truncation chops off all of the vertices. So I truncate, and what this does is you haven't seen anything yet. Right, so I just slice off the top of this, and I get these little triangular faces on the top. And then what's the idea? So now when I glue these truncated tetrahedra together, I do it in the same way as I did for the tetrahedra. So So these hexagonal faces get glued together. Now let's see, how did I want to draw this? Let's try drawing it like this. So this gets a little harder to draw, but I'm a professional, so surely I can do this. I'm going to stop doing this dotted line business, because when you start getting things behind other things behind other things, it stops becoming so useful. So here's another tetrahedron. And it's truncated. And there we go. Okay. So the thing that I want you to look at is this patch up here. I've got, as these two hexagonal faces are glued together, these two triangular faces you get from the truncation glue together along an edge. And so the idea is, here's the boundary of my manifold, and the boundary of my manifold is going to be a surface, right? So what's the boundary of this complement of the figure eight knot? It's this tube, well, it's a torus, in fact, which is what you got from drilling out the knot. And that tube is going to be triangulated by two-dimensional triangles. Make sense to everybody? So when I glue all these things together and the truncated ends glue together on the edges to make a surface. I guess I should mention, so the term triangulation makes a lot of sense for two-dimensional things because you're making it out of triangles. And for a couple of years around when I was getting my PhD, I was really trying to use the word tetrahedralization for the three-dimensional case, but eventually they wore me down and it's called a triangulation. So.
Is there a reason not to use rectangles?
Sorry?
Is there a reason not to use rectangles?
Sometimes there's things called cubulations, which are hot now. There's restrictions on how you can use them. So, I mean, it is an interesting thing that people think about, but it isn't quite as flexible. But it has some extra structure that does have some use. So have I said all this? Yes. Blah, 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 blah. So now we know what it means to have a triangulation by truncated tetrahedra. So I asked how many triangles you need to triangulate a torus, and now how many truncated tetrahedra do we need to triangulate the figure eight knot complement. Well, so there it is. So you can imagine putting truncated tetrahedra in here so that somehow the ends of the tetrahedra sort of poke through. The manifold's in here, the ends of the tetrahedra poke through, we chop them off to get the surface, and then it glues together to give this complicated thing in here. It's hard to imagine what the answer might be. It would be a very unfair question to ask you, so I'll just tell you the answer is that it's also two. This just seems astonishing to me that somehow you can arrange two truncated tetrahedra in here so that they're... So what is that? So the two truncated tetrahedra, that means there's eight little triangles on the edge. Those eight little triangles somehow wrap around this complicated torus, and the insides of those tetrahedra glue together to give this thing. So that's what I'm going to spend most of the rest of my time telling you about. I'm going to show you how this works. Mind-blowing. And then hopefully there'll be a little bit of time at the end, and I'll show you some of what this is useful for, what people get out of this construction. Okay, done with this sheet. So let's draw ourselves another figure eight knot complement. We're going to need quite a few of these. So here's the idea of the construction. So we're going to draw the knot on the plane. except where it goes slightly above and below at a crossing. So I'm actually drawing it on a plane, but you should think of it as being a curve in space that's pretty much on the plane, except that at these crossings it goes, it just bumps up a little bit or bumps down a little bit. And then what we're going to do is we're going to drop an edge at each crossing. And these are supposed to be in green for reasons that will become clear. So this strand here goes over this strand here, so I'm going to drop an edge sort of going vertically from one to the other. And let's see, there's another one here. And oh gosh, this picture is reflected from the one that's in my notes. Well, turns out that the figure eight knot is amphichiral, so it actually doesn't matter. But let me redraw it, because otherwise this is going to go very badly. Okay, so let's do it this way around. Yep, okay, here we go. All right, and let's do this again. So here's an edge at a crossing. Here's another edge at a crossing. Another one quite close to this one, and one down here. And I'm going to put arrows on these edges, which the meaning of which will become clear later on. So I've got single arrows on these two green edges, and a double arrow here, and a double arrow here. Okay. Extend this a little bit. There we go. So what's the idea? So we're going to, so we've got this thing sitting here in the plane. So we're going to inflate balloons above and below the plane. And they're going to expand until they meet wrapping around the knot. So here's the spoiler for what's going to happen. These two, I'm thinking of these two balloons that expand and wrap around and fill up the whole of space. Each of those balloons is eventually going to be one tetrahedron. And this is going to be the decomposition of this complement of the knot into these two tetrahedra. But initially, it doesn't seem likely that if you do this, you're going to get tetrahedra when you do this. Well, what does that even mean? We're going to expand these balloons out, and they're going to meet somehow, and we're going to see how those... So there's going to be sort of faces where these balloons meet, and then they sort of meet in different ways, and these faces show how to glue to how they're glued to each other, and there are edges between the... Let me carry on. It'll all become hopefully clear. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to work out how the balloons glue to each other. So let's suppose that, let's think about first we're nowhere near a crossing. So we've got this bit of a knot going through here, it's a tube that's been drilled out. I've got a balloon coming from the top, I've got a balloon coming from the bottom. What's it going to look like when they meet each other? So here's the picture away from a crossing. So here's my, the tube drilled out around my knot. And I'm just going to see something like this. I'm going to see above, maybe there's a, something like this. So here's the the balloon on the top, here's the balloon on the bottom, and they meet along these planes which meet at the knot and wrap around it. Okay. What's going on around a crossing? This is harder to see. But hopefully it will become clear. Let's draw a nice big picture. So here's the top strand, and here's the bottom strand. And I've got an edge which is going from the top strand to the bottom strand. This is probably a good time to get out my other visual aid. So hopefully you can see this. There's a black line. Well, so this is a piece of transparency, an ancient technology that you don't see anymore. And if I fold it up right like this, then I've got a top strand in black and a bottom strand in black, and then this green edge that goes between them. And the surface is this transparency here. So let me try and draw this on the board. I'm going to need this in a second, so I won't hand this around yet. Okay, so what's supposed to happen? So we know that, so let's look at this bit over here. So there's sort of four quadrants, and I need to understand what's going on in each of them. And I know that the surface is supposed to come along sort of at the mid-height line around this tube here. And then something happens here. Well, let me just sort of show you what happens. So I go along here. Let me put a bend in this surface like this. I'm going to bend it down 90 degrees. And I'm going to put another bend in here so that the surface comes along, bends, follows down this green line here, and then bends and then goes along this other knot. Does that make sense to people? And I'll sort of smooth it out as I get further out this way. And then it'll turn into the usual picture when I'm out there. Okay, so now what else is going on? Have I drawn my perspective badly? Maybe. So we've got this guy going along here. Let me draw it like this. So I've got another, it's the same thing again, really. Right, so it comes along here. Maybe I'll draw this like this. It bends like this, and then carries on. And then I draw the, and it's all symmetrical, so a little harder to see what's going on back here, but there's some sort of similar thing going on down here. And there's going to be some sort of similar thing going on here. Getting confused? No, here we go. Okay, so now let's look at this again. Hopefully, I don't know if you can see it from back there. This is a model of what I've drawn on the board. You get all of these sort of curves. Okay, lots of people are nodding. Good. Okay, so that's everything that happens. And now we need to write down... where's my black pen gone? Oh, here it is. Now we need to write down how do these parts glue to each other. So I'm going to label... There's going to be these big faces, so let's label these A, B, C, D on the outside, E, and F. So the outside is one big face as well. So I've got these A, B, and C are sort of little kind of triangular regions. D is also a triangular region, it's just very large. And then E and F are these bigon regions, where there only looks like there's only two edges. Notes, what am I writing down? So what do we need to do? We need to look at what's the pattern on the... Let's look first at the top balloon, because the pattern on the top balloon and the bottom balloon are going to be different. I'm going to see how they're going to glue together. So let's see so this is the pattern on the top balloon. So what's going on here? So the balloon is sort of, it touches in this region here, it touches in this region here, there's a little bit of knot in the way. And then as I go down here, what's happening? The top balloon sees into this sort of, this wedge shape here, and it sees this green line. But it's also going to see it coming from the other direction as well. So This is what this is supposed to demonstrate. Let's see, so here, so we're the top balloon. Let's see if I can line this up properly. That looks good. So we're the top balloon, and if I just bend this apart like this, then this is what the top balloon sees. I see this black edge, the black curve going through, and then two copies of the green curve, and then the black curve going the other way. And just as a, foreshadowing, the bottom balloon is gonna see this the other way. If I unwrap it so the bottom balloon is sort of unwrapped into just a sphere, then I see it split the other way. So let me just draw those pictures. Oh gosh, not a whole lot of time left. So the pattern on the top balloon looks like this. So I'm just gonna draw the tube just as a line. And it's gonna look like this. And on the bottom balloon, for the same picture, and I'm gonna be looking from the same direction, it's gonna split the other way. Like this. Does everybody believe this part? Wow, lots of people nodding. Amazing. Okay, so let's just do everything. So we're taking this picture, I'm gonna draw what it looks like from the top balloon, and we're gonna draw what it looks like from the bottom balloon. So on the top, so I guess I'll draw this first and then talk about why it's right. This and like this. This and this, this and this, and this and this, and these have arrows on them, which go in, out, double in, and double out. So let's just think about why this is true. So let's just consider this one up here. The top balloon, see this sort of wrapping around in like this, and then if I unglue it, I'm gonna see this green arrow twice and it's gonna be pointing towards the arc here. And so that's what I see here, this double arrow here. Okay, let's do the bottom one as well. The bottom looks sort of similar, but the other way around. See if I can get the arrows the right way around. Like this. Okay, and let's label these things with the regions that we get. A, B, C, D, E, and F. So these are the patterns on the two balloons that are gonna glue together to give this complement of the figure eight knot. Now, they still don't look like tetrahedra yet, but have faith. Because the next thing that's gonna happen is, remember that what we want at the end is that these little pointy ends of the tetrahedra are very small, in fact. And the little pointy ends of the tetrahedra, that's where the knot is. So actually, let me just slightly redraw these, or maybe I'll just do one of them. So if you unwrap the tube as the balloon is wrapping around the tube, you're actually gonna see a little quadrilateral here. Well, it's quite a large quadrilateral, but it has four vertices here. There's the one here, there's two here, and there's one here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna shrink all of those regions, because they're on the knot. They're supposed to be these little triangles. I'm gonna shrink them down. It's gonna be the same combinatorics, but it's gonna look slightly different after I shrink. So shrink the knot regions. So if I do this, then the top looks like this. I guess after I've drawn this, you can go through and check and make sure that it's really the same thing. Da, 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 da. This goes like this. Oh, let's label them A, B, C, D, E, and F. So let's just pause for a minute and say, is this the same picture as that picture? So, I mean, let's look at this E. This E region was a square region which had two blue arrows and two black edges. Yep. All of the black regions here are supposed to be little quadrilaterals, little squares. Yep. And if you go through and check everything, I've just distorted the picture. I haven't done anything interesting at all. All right, let's do the bottom. Let's see, how long do I have, incidentally? 5 minutes? Ooh, 7 minutes. Maybe I won't draw the other one. It looks really similar to this one. okay, and this is looking kind of more tetrahedral, right? This is what I want to get to. What I want to get to is this with these things in here. Whoops. And the appropriate arrows on all of the edges. And what's stopping me is these regions E and F. So there's these little bygones that are sort of messing everything up, and then there's these two edges either side. So this is going to be a little tricky, and I'm not really going to say what happens and why, but you can think about this. We just want to squeeze those bygones together and squeeze them flat, squeeze them shut. And if you do that, and if you believe me that you can do that, then this is what you end up with, and you end up with two of these tetrahedra. But let me just comment over here. This is why these arrows, these two were the single arrow guys. In fact, it's easy to see here. These two double arrow guys and the bygone F in between them, if you just think about taking this edge, this green edge here, and sliding it along the knot, it turns into the other edge. There's nothing interesting going on between them. It was just to help us understand the picture to have those extra edges. But really, you can just squeeze those shut. Everything's going to be the same. It's just harder to see how the balloons are interacting with each other. Okay, so let's not talk about that part. Let me just show you something that you can do with these triangulations. Is this going to work? Yes, we do. So there's a program called Snappy, which is developed by Jeff Weeks and now Nathan Dunfield and Mark Culler. And this is a... Thanks, Scott. So this is a program that topologists use to understand manifolds. And so here's what you can do. So I can, if I want, just like somehow input the data of a triangulation, or I can just draw a knot. So let's just draw a knot. Okay, is this the figure eight knot? No, because my crossings are wrong. What do I need to do? Which way did I have it? So this crossing, whoops. How do I quit this thing? Okay, we've got a little thing here. Can I delete that? let me try that again. There is a way to delete that, but I've never known how to do that. You just have to not do the extra click. Okay, so now is this crossing the right way around? No. Okay, so I can just flip the crossing. Over, under, this should be over. Under, over. This looks right. Okay, then I can just say, okay, let's send it back to... So now the computer knows about my manifold. All I've done is I've told you then there's this triangulation. And so I can ask it, how many tetrahedra do you think this has? Oh, it's pretty good. There are two tetrahedra in this thing. And then there are all kinds of things that you can calculate about this. Let me just show you. You have this fancy interface for getting all kinds of information about the three manifold that you get when you drill this thing out. So I mean, I'm not going to really say anything about this. The volume, this is hyperbolic volume, things to do with the fundamental group. Let me show you a couple of things. Oh, yes, somehow it knows what the knot was, but it's drawn it a different way. This is a pretty picture, which is somehow, this is the pattern of what you get as you look from the outside, from the drilled part out into the manifold. So you see there are all of these little triangles here. So those triangles are these triangular ends of the tetrahedra that are glued together to form a torus, which is this drilled out bit of the knot. And you can actually see this purple rectangle here, that's the knot, and it's supposed to be glued together in these two different ways to give the torus boundary. And I guess let me just finish with this. This is the Dirichlet domain. So this is incidentally, this is showing us, as it happens in this case, the triangulation again. So what is going on here? Really, so maybe this is a little hard to see, but what's going on here is there's a tetrahedron here. This is sitting inside of hyperbolic space, if that matters to you, great. If not, don't worry. And there's a tetrahedron, and stuck onto the four faces of this tetrahedron are very short, flat tetrahedra. And what's actually happening is there's a tetrahedron in the middle, and then the other tetrahedron has been cut up into four little little pyramids. Let me just draw a picture of that. So here's a tetrahedron. If I add a vertex in the middle and draw an edge to each vertex, and hopefully you can see that it's cut up into four little tetrahedra. And each of those four little tetrahedra glued onto one of the faces of the central tetrahedron in the middle. So this is actually the same decomposition into two tetrahedra as the one we started with. And if you know anything about hyperbolic geometry, you know the prettiest pictures are not using the Klein model, they're using the Poincaré model instead. So anyway, yes, you get a lot of, you can calculate all kinds of information about.
So in that picture, faces of the same color are being identified.
That is true, yes, that's exactly what's happening. So this is cut up into those four tetrahedra, you get these extra sub-edges, and those are glued together according to culling. But anyway, I think I'm out of time, so thank you very much.
We'll take questions, but we now have the rule that students get to ask questions first. So, first questions from students.
Yeah.
This might be really stupid, but here you say that it's better to use truncated tetrahedra. Why is that?
Well, so it's more efficient. So you could describe this thing using just ordinary tetrahedra. And then in order to describe the boundary, there would have to be some faces of the tetrahedra that weren't glued to other ones. And, right, so you'd have the, right, so the way that I've described it, these sort of big triangles are always glued to some other big triangle of some tetrahedron. So you can describe a manifold with boundary by just having some of those gluings not happen. But it turns out that if you do that, you need a lot of tetrahedra. And so it just becomes harder to calculate and understand what's going on. So it just turns out that it's a much more efficient way to calculate things to use truncated tetrahedra. But it's a good question, yeah. Yeah?
I have a stupid question. So when you're drawing at the top and the bottom,
yeah,
why are the A's and B's on the same side?
Ah, yeah, so what I'm doing is I'm drawing the picture on the top as viewed from inside of the top balloon. And I'm drawing the picture on the bottom as seen from outside the bottom balloon. Because otherwise it gets really confusing. But yes, if I had enough time to actually go through and draw all of them, then at one point I would have said, okay, now I need to turn this picture over so I can see both of these tetrahedra from the outside. But otherwise, doing the mirror reflection, where do the crossings go? It's not so easy.
Are there any other interesting triangulation numbers?
Well, right. So every three manifold can be triangulated. So all knot complements, all these other things. This is a really nice, simple example. But yeah, I mean, there are all of the lists of the Rolfson knots, the knot tables. There's you can just maybe I can do this now. So let's say N is, where is this going to work? Manifold L, do you remember the notation? 3, 1, something like that. This may not work.
I don't think you use L.
It's just 3, 1? Okay, so let's see. Well, it's going to tell me it has two tetrahedra. So 3-1 is the trefoil, which I drew a long time ago. It turns out you can also triangulate that with two tetrahedra. Let's do let's just change it with L. No, not L. 5-2. That's a knot. Tetrahedra. That has three tetrahedra. As the knots get more complicated, the number of tetrahedra you need gets larger. I should mention, there isn't just one way to triangulate this. There are infinitely many ways to triangulate any three-manifold. So, I mean, this is just finding a nice, simple way to do it, so you can do some calculations. But yeah, I mean, in general, any knot complement has infinitely many triangulations. It's a big problem trying to organize this information. There's just so many different triangulations. How do you tell if two triangulations are triangulations of the same manifold or not? So I mean, there's a lot of interesting questions, and sometimes you get a really nice example. Yeah. Yeah.
So are these like minimum triangulation numbers specific to the projection of your knot, or is it?
Right. So, you're not going to get better than two tetrahedra for the figure eight knot period.
Yeah.
So what Snappy does when I draw this picture and it calculates stuff, it's not guaranteeing that this is the minimal triangulation for this particular knot complement.
Okay.
Generally speaking, it does pretty well. And, I mean, what you can do, you can actually kick it and say, give me another triangulation. Like, just try and find something smaller. And sometimes that works. You're not guaranteed that you're getting the best possible. Although, in terms of, like, calculating things, like, you know, all these invariants and the volume and whatever, you don't really care which one you have, generally speaking.
Yeah.
It's just that, you know, you'd prefer to have one that has 5 tetrahedra rather than 300. So, yeah.
I guess my real question is, for just any projection of the figure, can it always be triangulated with two?
There's two things to say. One is, I mean, the triangulation doesn't care what your projection is. I think when you draw something to give to this computer program, it has to take your projection and do something with it.
Yeah.
So it's going to depend on that in some way. But I mean, the triangulation has forgotten the fact that there was a projection. The second thing to say is, this construction doesn't work in general. There are things that go wrong when you have other knots. So the way that Snappy does it is not quite the same as what I've done here. I think if you don't have an alternating knot, if it doesn't go over, under, then you get some weird things that don't work well at all nicely. And then, I mean, the other thing to say is, I mean, this construction is only ever going to find you things which have two balls. So you're going to get two balls which have some sort of pattern that get glued together. But if you want a triangulation and these balls are some more complicated polyhedra, then maybe you have to subdivide them or something. I mean, it gets pretty complicated. But yeah, I mean, there's many, many different constructions of how do you chop this up, hopefully in a useful way. I mean, Scott studies a different way of cutting up manifolds in a useful way.
All right, let's thank Henry.
All right. Thank you.